Okay, well, first of all, it's fantastic to be here, as usual. Big thanks to Marcel and Guy for organizing, and Alan, as a matter of fact. Big thanks to the lecturers who have done a wonderful job in the past 2 days, Frederic and Thierry. I actually was hoping that Marcel would introduce the project, so I don't have slides for that. But let me say a few words. The conference is one of the workshops of Simon's collaboration on localization of waves, the concourse that we have won this summer in July. It's devoted, as the title says, to localization of waves. Not the way you think about it, whatever it is that you think. Meaning that the coverage is actually from vibrations, mechanical vibrations, to quantum physics, to questions in mathematics devoted to fractal domains, to localization by geometry, to understand localization, and everything in between, and from pure mathematics, very pure mathematics, to very experimental physics. Off the top of my head, the executive committee is Marcel Filoche and Doug Arnold, representing respectively physics and computational mass. I probably still stand for pure mass. And otherwise, we have 10 PIs, including, aside from us, Yves Meyer, Guy David, David Jerrison. I'm now counting. Alana Speck, Lord Weisbusch, Jim Speck, Richard Friend. Am I forgetting anybody? So that includes organic and non-organic semiconductors, experiments with cold atoms, theoretical physics, and geometric measures theory, harmonic analysis, computational mass. Anything you think about this. So since I'm in a somewhat official capacity here, sadly I cannot plunge right into mathematics, and I'll try to give you an overview of the project. Some of you have heard some parts of it. I will be very fast and sort of just flash the main. It's been 10 years exactly of the project by now. We've met and started it about the same time in the conference in Orleans, about 10 years ago, as a matter of fact. So there have been many developments in many directions, and people leading them are mostly here in this room. So my main job is sort of to redirect you to them, depending on your interest, and to show you some highlights of our approach to localization. Okay, now let's assume my time starts.
You can trust them. Uh-huh.
Well, then we're here forever. <it's> All right. So, first of all, the wave localization, the way it was introduced to me exactly 10 years ago by now, was localization by geometric features of the domain. So take the usual Laplace's operator, directly boundary conditions, no potential, no Schrodinger, no nothing. Of course, in a square or rectangular domain, you have plane waves looking like products of sines and cosines. Nonetheless, if the domain has a more complicated geometry, so here we are imposing directly boundary conditions on this white line, it's possible that the vibrations localize. Localize meaning, in physicists' words, big over there, small over here, whatever that means. But the question was, given any domain, will the vibrations localize in principle? What triggers this feature? What particular features of the geometry? For which frequencies, for which energies would they be localized? Because unlike somewhat more familiar to many of you case of Anderson localization, it could be that it's a finite domain, it's a discrete spectrum. So it could be that the first eigenfunction is localized, the second is not, the fifth is localized again, and so on. In which subregions? Because here, well, you could sort of say that this is separated, but would you have localization over here? Would you have localization elsewhere? And finally, how severely? What is meant by large or small, and how do you prove it? aside from a few ad hoc results, which actually go back to Courant and Hilbert, there have been virtually no mathematical treatment of these questions when we have started. But that never prevented physicists from making progress. And in particular, already at that moment, based on the ideas of localization, I have built the following noise abatement wall, which has held world record of noise abatement back then, possibly now. Bernard Sapoval is there, and Marcel Filosh is here, are the main people in the... Actually, I think it's the first time I'm giving this talk in front of Bernard. Are the main people involved in this, but that doesn't prevent from the fact that there has been virtually no mathematical treatment, rigorous mathematical treatment of this effect. So that's one flash at localization, maybe familiar to some of you. Another one, and many of you will say completely, totally different one, is of course Anderson localization by disorder. In this case, localization is induced by disorder and the potential V. And as we learned in 2 days of lectures, and many of you know already, you take a random potential, whatever it is that you mean by it. This one is Bernoulli, meaning 0, 1 randomly on a grid. Eigenfunctions are localized, localized exponentially. This is not the best picture, it's periodic, but on an infinite domain, just an exponential decay. This is proved, but that's not the question that I'm asking. This is, let's pretend it's continuous, so it's proved even for Bernoulli. The questions we are asking are completely different. Fix a finite domain. Random potential, same story, finite domain. You still have a discrete spectrum. You still need to, there is a first eigenfunction, second, third. Would you be able to say, looking at this domain, where is the first, where is the second, where is the third? What exactly are the shapes of the supports? I mean, there is some geometry to this object. What are the sizes, not statistically, but actually precisely for particular eigenfunctions? What is the structure of exponential decay? One thing this picture shows, so this is a log of the same eigenfunction. And the point is that exponential decay does not happen uniformly. It's not the eigenfunction. We know that the eigenfunctions of Anderson potential decay exponentially. But they are not decaying uniformly. There are lines of exponential drop, which you can see very clearly here in numerical experiments. What is the structure of the eigenfunction? And finally, what is the local information about the spectrum? You might know some global features, but at a given point, what is the local density of states and things like this? And many, many similar questions. Now, if you have some sort of illusion that you understand these questions, let me bring you to the painful real world, led by people in semiconductors here. Now we are up, I'll just flash the mathematics of it, and Claude will be talking about the more serious things. Now you are still in the context of the Schrodinger equation. Disordered Schrodinger equation, we have random content of indium. This is gallium nitride, indium gallium nitride semiconductor. But the mathematics behind it, the equations, the reality behind it, is that it's not a simple Schrodinger equation. It's a nonlinear, self-consistent, formally speaking, infinite system. Because not only the eigenfunctions satisfy the potential, but the potential itself depends on the eigenfunction. So let me do the baby version. Every physicist will oppose because it sort of strips of physical meaning, but it's a mathematical, it's the simplest I can do out of it to show you what it means. It's as though you are solving Schrodinger with some background potential, let's say random, plus another potential, which by itself is a solution to the Poisson problem. Laplacian of V equals something, plus the coefficients times the sum of Ci squared. So notice these are all your eigenfunctions on the right-hand side. So to know the potential, you need to know all the eigenfunctions. To know the eigenfunctions, you need to know the potential. And this loops. So the only way you can possibly, first of all, it's an extremely nonlinear dependence. It's a system, it's not an equation, it doesn't separate in any way. But more importantly, it takes the self-consistent solution. It's not even clear why it converges. It does, but it doesn't converge. It doesn't converge very fast. And then again, there are several layers of difficulties. I'm really stripping it of everything. Semiconductors have it all. You have irregular geometry because interfaces. You have actually not the Laplacian, but something of the sort dy grad. because you have coefficients there. You have coupled electrons and holes, and you need to have local information because you need to know how electrons interact with holes. And so you need some local information about that. And even, yes?
There are two Laplacians coming into your set of equations, right?
Yes.
And in the second item, you have Laplacians should be divergence A gradient. Which one is it? Both of them? Second one?
As a matter of fact, both of them, this one is more serious.
Okay.
The second one.
Okay. And the other question is the coefficients depending on the eigenvalues, anything known on them or any.
You mean.
Any knowledge what they look like? Yeah, in your baby model.
In the baby model, so I can tell you that there is in the baby model, which is very far from the real model, there is tiny bit of the new work on the fact that you can set up Anderson localization questions, basically, in the formalism of that there is some information on density of states and something like that. But the very, what you teach in the first course in some sense, so very, very, and only in the baby model and only in some information. If you mean the coefficients, these ones, these are clear. It's not, I'm just not writing them because of the formula. There is a formula. It depends on the Fermi levels and so on. So these are, roughly speaking, exponentially decaying with E, depending on the temperature. So this is clear, but this is not. Because your potential is induced by the...
Just know what's known about the coefficients of the equation.
They are known. These ones are known, it's roughly speaking exponentially decaying, and with temperature it's more and more vivid.
Okay.
All right, so most of this will go back to Claude, but my point is this is the scope of sense that we are considering. The punchline of the entire project is actually a point of view which magically unites them all and answers some of these questions, and of course we have a lot of work to do ahead of us to answer more. So the main point is that in order to understand all these questions, you need to put on the goggles of a wave. That when you look at the equation, you ask about the coefficients, you might know the material which gives you the coefficients, you might know the potential, the geometry and so on, that's what you see. What the wave sees is rather complex, very intricate, but very well-ordered landscape, which prescribes both the geometries of the eigenfunctions, the shapes of their supports, and the eigenvalues, the actual energies of the system, to which extent we are going to discover as it goes. So for us, the story started, mathematical story of this, about now 8 years ago. From the inequality, which is so simple in retrospect and so powerful that it should have been discovered 100 years ago. Yet, to the best of our knowledge, it didn't, it wasn't. But let me briefly show you. It's very, very simple. You have any positive operator of your personal liking, Laplacian, Bi-Laplacian, the domain, Schrödinger, as long as potential is positive, anything you like. You solve h u equals 1, h being your operator, 1. The eigenfunctions are h phi equals lambda phi, this is 1. Then any normalized eigenpair satisfies normalized in L infinity here, satisfies the pointwise bound, psi of x is less than energy times u of x. The magic of it is that u is unique for everybody. U is defined by the operator, but it's the same function for everybody, for all eigenfunctions. The fact that they all have the same measurement is magic in itself. Because think about this, they could be sines and cosines, they are running all over the place, or they could be exponentially localized bumps, they could be anything in the world, and certainly they are distributed all over the domain. The fact that there is one common measurement for all the eigenfunctions is sort of surprising. And this is what started us. And the observation that is, at least for the small energies in this particular formalism, when u is small, all eigenfunctions have to be small. So this u, which we are going to refer to as the landscape, and that's what you should be thinking about, mountains and valleys, the places where there are valleys, the places where u is small, introduces artificial boundaries, which eigenfunctions have hard time passing. It's not exactly zero, but nonetheless, it's just suppressing, and it's defining either nodal sets or localization regions. And it's actually localization regions, and we are going to talk about why. But this was the first idea. And the first system on which we tested it back then, because of Marcel's interest in geometry and my interest in bioloplasion at the time, was localization by geometry. We throwed in all kinds of simple yet different geometry we knew, which is clamped points, crack, and bottleneck in the domain. And we looked at two cases, Laplacian and bioloplasion. So if you're a mathematician, take it Laplacian and bioloplasion. If you are a physicist, the first one corresponds to vibrations of a soft membrane, so it's as though you have a drum of this shape with this geometry, and this is vibration of a drum. And the bioloplasion corresponds to the vibrations of a rigid drum, of a rigid membrane. So iron plate or a wooden plate, something like this. So it's a drum with, which is iron drum, basically. So this is more rigid. Amazingly, the landscape is different. In the case of the Laplacian, it separates the domain into two regions. This is the landscape. There is one valley. There is sort of big mountain here and smaller mountain here. There are two subregions. And in the case of the bioloplasion, it's quite different from that. It separates the domain into four regions. So according to our, at this point, still naive philosophy, this should define for you the regions of localization. And guess what? In the first case, these are the first six eigenfunctions, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, exactly in the subregions predicted by the landscape. And in the case of the bioloplasion, different landscape, different subregions, exact correspondence once again. I will not discuss it in too many details, but I'll mention that shortly afterwards, well, not that shortly, but afterwards, this has been confirmed experimentally by the team led by Patrick Sebakum, I've seen but don't see anymore. Yes, there. So he will be talking about this. This was the first experimental verification of the landscape theory. And one thing that I want to say, I understand that many of you come from quantum physics or mathematics associated with it. One piece of beauty about the story is that in this case, the landscape has a very clear physical meaning. The solution to Laplace equals 1, or in this case, bioLaplace equals 1, is a deflection of a plate under uniform load. 1 on the right-hand side means you are pushing uniformly. It's a static deflection, so you take your plate, you push it uniformly with load 1. You see it's static, you see the creases appearing, and these ones are your valleys. So you actually can see and measure the landscape. It's a clear physical object. You don't need to know what equation governs it. You don't need to know what's the material. You don't need to know if it's homogeneous or not. You actually don't need to know the geometry. Nothing whatsoever. You can measure the landscape and compare to the eigenfunctions or just use it for prediction of the shapes. And that's basically what has been done. You can see here experimental measurements and the pretty good correspondence. You can see more here. I will not go over the effective stuff, but this is numerical simulations. Experiment is honestly even more vivid. And there are more results that Patrick will be talking about. The next application, which came much, much later and is actually not published still, it's an active work, but nonetheless relates closely to that part of the story, is the application to molecular vibrations in proteins or to catalytic efficiency of enzymes. This is collaboration with Marcel and Francesco Piazza, and Jan Shalapan is probably the main person in the story, and again, I'm missing everybody, but he's somewhere here and will be presenting. So this is now about the topology of molecular networks. So the molecules look, roughly speaking, this way. You are treating them as coupled harmonic oscillators. So each node is a node, and between them, imagine small screens. So you have coupled harmonic oscillators. I'll stop the movie, but you got the point. And every oscillator has its own constant to it. So you have, mathematically speaking, you have some sort of a, you have some sort of an elasticity system. And after a lot of pain, you manage to make it into something workable and introduce the landscape to it. And what landscape gave is the clustering, the subpartitioning of this molecular network into individual clusters, and the location of the active sites, the ones in red here, which are responsible for enzymatic efficiency, within 0.2% of the length of the protein. So roughly speaking, in 50% of cases, we are getting it exactly on the point, and in the other 50%, it's the neighboring site. But this is at the level of molecules. So getting it anywhere nearby is actually amazing by itself. Here you see the graphs corresponding to it. So on about 10,000 active sites, we are pointing out exactly what are the correct ones, again with 0.2% precision. All right, Jan will have a poster about that, but meanwhile, let's get greedy and go into Anderson potentials. So here the potential is the uniform one, meaning that you chop the domain into pieces and then assign anything between 0 and 1 uniformly, independently. According to our idea, you take the landscape, you record the values, and you pray that they actually show you the regions of localization. So let's see if that happens. I'm bringing up here the, this is work from 2012 with Marcel and PNAS, but the actual computations I show were done by Doug Arnold later on with respect to another project. They just look more serious than ours. They are more serious than ours. So this is back Bernoulli potential, now 80 by 80, landscape, values of the landscape. Let's see, landscape itself, first eigenfunction exactly within the promised regions, second repeats it even with the shape, third, fourth. We used to have a movie about it. It's a pretty boring movie. It's sort of, they walk over individual sites of described by the landscape, but the precision is really miraculous. Yes?
How many eigenvalues did you test on this? I mean, imagine that I take the thousands eigenvalues.
With this, so what happens is, wait a little bit, you'll understand why, but eventually they're sort of breaking free.
Sure. No, I
and it's a finite domain, so they follow the landscape okay. as
they
long as it's promised.
When they are low enough.
When they are low enough.
Okay, sure.
But the magic of it is that it's not the same as following V when V is low enough. Meaning that V here is completely percolating from day one. There is no...
What do you mean completely percolating?
I mean that you could walk from any... Look at this potential.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
it's 70% white. So there is no confinement in V.
That's not true. Quantumly there is, but okay, that's...
There is no classical confinement in V.
No classical, that's no problem, but quantum there is. That's
well, of course, that's the point, that there is a quantum confinement, but you cannot draw the regions from here. You do not know,
well,
it's interferential.
That's the point of quantum
either.
Well, it's not about rough sense, but let's go on and then discuss and then, because there is a lot to this. Yes.
A much more basic question. In previous pictures, sometimes you'd be localized in two separate regions.
Yes.
But all of these seem to live in just one region.
There is an exponentially improbable resonance, but it still can occur. And if it occurs, well, you resonate. But we'll get there. Mm-hmm. Anyway, Frederick, I promise it will become clearer very soon what I'm heading to. All right, so this is the situation, but then you are becoming even greedier. And as we discussed, there are very clear lines of exponential drop of the eigenfunction. The lines of the exponential drop can be described if you see the grad of sin. If you look at the grad of log of the eigenfunction, you can see that it's blue part of the time. Blue means it's reasonably uniform, so there is no exponential drop there. And the red lines here are the lines where the exponential drop happens. If you look at this, you will actually have the answer to your question. I swear. If you look at this, you will have an answer to your question from the previous slide. This is the structure of the exponential decay. This is the landscape superimposed on the...
Which eigenfunction is that?
Well, any localized. I mean, this is probably fundamental, but... Maybe tens, I don't remember exactly, I mean. This is the structure of the exponential decay.
Uh-huh.
This is the landscape superimposed on the structure of the exponential decay. With all due respect, there is no existing method. and you can argue, but I'll be happy to see, that can draw you a priori the lines of the exponential drop of an eigenfunction, the structure of the exponential drop of the eigenfunction with this precision. In red, you have the lines of exponential drop. In black, you have the values of the landscape. Do you have a reference which does that?
Well, I guess the paper you're quoting.
All right, so this is in big so that you believe that I'm not cheating on sizes here. And now the actual meat of it. So what's happening, and this is sort of a physics slide, but I think it's very telling. So what happens was understood somewhat later when Doug Arnold and Guy David and David Cherison have joined the project. And it turned out that it's actually magical and just a coincidence that the very same landscape controls this picture. In the following sense, it's not a point-wise control. Of course it's not, because you are describing exponential decay, you are 10 to minus 7, there is no point-wise control there. It turns out that you can rewrite the original Schrödinger equation. Just rewrite, identically. And get another equation, which is, roughly speaking, homogeneous to Laplacian in the principal term, and in which the potential is 1 over u. So the potential v is completely forgotten. 1 over u, 1 over the same landscape of u, is the leading potential here. And otherwise, the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions, if renormalized, are the same. So the point is that 1 over u can be treated as a potential. The point is that what we used to see as valleys now becomes walls. And the difference, you could say, well, I mean, one potential, another potential, so what? The difference is that v, as I mentioned, in many examples of those is completely percolating, and as all of you know, even if it's not, you cannot read it off as confinement. It's a different sort of localization. 1 over u, on the other hand, has this very clear structure of wells and walls. So it's rearranging the information. It takes the information, which is a priori interferential and partially long range, and introduces it into, or translates it into, very local information, which looks like confinement. This is a tool. This is a, I mean, if you won't think of the Fourier series or things like this, it's a translation. But it's a translation which translates interferential effects into something looking like confinement effects in this new logic. It's not really confinement, but I mean, it's the way wave sees it. And from there, you can prove the exponential decay according to distance associated to 1 over u and things like this. So theorems for a change. Let's see, for simplicity, minus Laplacian plus v is your potential, v is positive and bounded. You can miss everything else. Take 1 over u. So once again, you are reversing it. What used to be a value is now a wall. And cut it at the level of energy lambda. So you have a potential 1 over u. You cut it at the level of energy that you are talking about. You take the positive part of that, 1 over u minus lambda, positive part of it. That's a manifold. You have a metric on this manifold. And according to this metric induced by 1 over u minus lambda, there is an exponential decay. So an eigenfunction decays exponentially, indeed, when it crosses the walls of the potential 1 over u. And again, for a change, there are walls. And that's the explanation of that exponential decay, of the structure of the exponential decay viewed by 1 over u that you saw previously in the slides. This is accompanied by the decoupling theorems, or if you want, diagonalization theorems. And what I mean by this is you have this separation into subregions. And now you can prove that with the exponential precision, every eigenfunction of the big domain has a friend which is an eigenfunction of the small domain, and vice versa. And this goes back to Max's question, it could can possibly have two friends, but that's an exponential precision, so they have to share an eigenvalue, which is exponentially tight. So this is a separation into exponentially weakly coupled regions. Once again, you are translating the global information into the local information. You actually see the regions. Of course, everybody talks and works with the resonance as an Anderson case, but this is local. Same for the eigenvalues. The theorems, the idea that once you have 1/U as a potential, you can pull something like this off, is of course not new, because if you had a confining potential, you could do it, in particular due to the work of Helfer-Schostrand, and Bernard Helfer should be here, maybe not just yet. Yes, there. So for the original potential V, it has been done, well, the first ideas were due to Agman, that's the name Agman distance, but it has actually been worked out into real mathematics by Helfer and Schostrand. But the point is that for the original potential, the distance in question would be exactly zero because of this full percolation. These are confinement effects a priori. And here we managed to work with 1/U. So what's the difference? Why, yet again, why 1/U is so much better? Well, look at the energy of the system. The identity I showed you a couple of slides ago lets you rewrite the full energy, kinetic plus potential energy, as some sort of a tiny reduced energy plus potential energy with 1/U. In many, many examples, what happens, and in particular in all the examples that I showed you, what happens is that this term is not only positive, which lets you prove the theorems, but also tiny. So this is very important. What 1/U does, it combines the kinetic energy and the potential energy. It eats it all up. It digests it somehow. And it spits out the effective potential energy, which is essentially the leading term. Everything else is very small. In particular in the example of an infinite quantum well, which is known to most of us as the Dirichlet problem on the finite segment, you have the left-hand side, which is, well, because it's an infinite quantum well, the left-hand side has all the energy in the kinetic term. So this is 100%, this is 0%. The right-hand side has 4% in the reduced kinetic term and 96% in the effective potential. So all of the energy has been pushed forward into information in the potential 1/U. And this is what it does. So it's some sort of a perfection of the uncertainty principle, if you want. The uncertainty principle tells you that there is something in the kinetic energy that you actually cannot disregard. There are many, many methods in mathematics continuously improved, and some of the most relevant improvements here is Pfefferman-Fong results and so on, from the 80s now. But this is actually better than that, because once again, you are getting all of the information about kinetic and potential energy, all of the uncertainty principle combined in one object. Yet again, so that gives you this translation mechanism, and that's why this is so powerful. This further gives some ideas of the transport, because you have the very specific exponential decay. Because you are having this distance on the manifold, there is a very clear passage of least resistance, if you want, which gives you a passage of transport defined by the Agman distance associated to 1/U. I won't go into details. This is the work of Marcel and his student, Lantalia. Probably he will have a poster. But let me mention a couple of things. So what does it do and doesn't do in the particular context of Anderson localization? Aside from the fact that we don't care that much, because that's not the center of our attention. What it does is that it gives you a very clear local disjoint partition of the domain into exponentially coupled regions. Again, it translates all of this long range magical interferential interactions into something very, very local. It does not tell you anything about the probability of resonances, which is of course what you need to analyze if you are to go into direction of proving the Anderson localization. But yet again, that's not the point. It has been proved, we are not proven it. So resonances are still to be analyzed here. But on the other hand, what it does, it gives you the local information and it gives you the structure of the exponential decay. And this is what I keep emphasizing. It gives you the actual geometric information on this. The only comparable result, to the best of my knowledge, is very recent by Svitlana Mayboroda and her student Wen Kailiu, just published in Annals in 2018 when they do it for the almost Mati operator, which physicists call Aubry André, and Thierry was talking about this in connection with the cold atoms. So this is the only comparable result on the structure of the eigenfunctions. We tried it with the landscape in this context, and again, Marcel has a student who will be presenting a poster on this. So if you are interested, please take a look. But I'll go on meanwhile. So another direction which has been explored here, and I won't scare you, but I will only, let me see if I'm doing well on time. But I do want to mention it. When I started with the localization by geometry, those of you who work in quantum physics probably thought that it has nothing to do with it. The point is that this picture of the landscape translates for you what used to be a language of the potential into now the language of the geometry. Everything is defined by these subregions, which are given you both eigenfunctions and eigenvalues, because again, your eigenfunctions and eigenvalues of the global system, I give or take eigenfunctions and eigenvalues of them. So you need to know the geometry of the subregions. This is defining a lot of features in your system. You might or might not have noticed that I have never defined them. I defined the landscape, but I have never said what are the valleys, or what are the walls, or what are any of that. And the truth is that there are several definitions. None of them is super easy to handle, and you need to pick up some which is good for mathematical purposes. They're give or take equivalent, but not completely. This one, and this is the work we did in, roughly speaking, 2014, which was eventually published by in 2017. That's when Guy David and eventually David Jellison joined the project. It's the work on the geometry of this localization subregions from the point of view of free boundary problems. Why is it relevant? Well, here is a connection. So this is what the landscape regions look like. What they might or should remind you of is something like a bubble form. Now, bubble forms are part of the famous plateau problem in mathematics, part of the direction devoted to free boundaries. And the idea of that big, big, big direction of research in math is to be able to go from PDE properties to geometric properties. Why bubbles are kind of round, spherical? Well, because every system tries to minimize energy, and the minimal shape is a sphere. And then there are much more complicated ideas than that, and the topology of this, and what happens at the boundary, and so on. But that's the basic idea, that by minimizing a certain functional, which is secretly what your system does, you can figure out what's the geometry of the individual subregions. Same happens here, except that you have the potential. In bubbles, there is no potential. Here, you have this random potential, which distorts the picture a little bit. But you can measure this distortment, and you can nonetheless prove that something like that happens, that the regions are reasonably plumpy in the sense that there is a big ball inside and the big ball outside, and so on and so forth. You prove rectifiability in mathematical language and things like this. This is only the start, but this is some idea of this direction, and if you want to go further, probably Guy David is the right person to talk, or David Jellison. I meanwhile will switch to the eigenvalues, because I promised to you both eigenfunctions and eigenvalues, and I haven't talked about the second ones yet. And to start with that, I will start with a game which actually was devised by Doug. Super neat idea. In connection with our computational paper. So you take a potential which you can see over here. From 0 to 4, randomly, uniformly, on the interval of length 256. Can you tell me where is the first eigenfunction? Anyone? Well, you can. Actually, I'm not sure. Can you? Do you remember? Anyone?
So you take the deepest well.
Okay, so deepest is this one?
Well, it's a little broader.
This one's a little.
So which one you bet on, Alan?
Well, on the left, it's broader.
This one or this one? This one?
Yes, a compromise between the width and the. But I played the role of the idiot, okay? Useful idiot.
This is. Anyone else? Or where is the second one if you want?
Well, there's another one that is pretty wide and deep as well.
So you think it's this one?
Yeah, a little bit. I put the energy
here.
No, not on the bottom. Actually, it's going to be.
No,
but
No. My question is which well location.
The well, yeah. Right,
so you think it's this one?
Wide and.
Okay, we have three bets.
Yes.
Let's instead of this, let's look at the effective potential on the 1 over U, which we renamed as effective potential.
We were right.
Unlike the, well, let's see, which of you were right? You had three different guesses. So this is 1 over U now. And now I don't have to guess. Meaning what? We just record the minimum of 1 over U.
It's not bad, huh?
You were right.
We're not that much off, actually.
Let's see how they go in round two.
Let's see how the round two will go. Anyway, so this is exactly the minimum of 1 over U in the order of appearance. This is the width of the corresponding wells. This is the eigenfunctions in the order of appearance, 1, 2, 3, 4. So yeah, you made it into first four, each of you. We won't report the winners officially, but you all know who you are. So yes, the first one was that, second, third, fourth. But my point is, yet again, you are sort of digesting all of this information. I mean, yes, width matters, and yes, depth matters, and it's not completely clear how it matters, and of course, in more complicated and more dimensional system, less so. But having the landscape, having 1 over U, they just appear in the order of the appearance of the minima. Now, unfortunately, I have not read on. Let me just talk about this. I have not read on it, I'm sorry. Because I'm not the one who does computations. But let me just talk about this. So let's try with the same potential. Where is the potential? There, the potential. And imagine that instead of maximum 4, I have maximum 256. Where are the minima now? So instead of 4 here, I have 256. The rest is the same. It's rescaled. Do we have the same order?
Yes. You mean you multiply the potential by a coupling constant?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
By exactly 64, to be precise. Do we have the same order?
I doubt.
So what changes? Where are now the first, the second?
Divide the fraction by 1 over 64, you put smaller fraction.
And?
So what does this mean? This means it localizes more the eigenfunctions, so actually it's going to be the deeper wells, right, which have, then you still need to have some.
But which one?
The lower well, I'd go for, there are two deep ones, one just, be, yeah, exactly.
This
yeah,
one? This one?
Here,
let's see.
Zero.
So here is the landscape.
Yes. The lowest one.
This is the new landscape.
Yeah, yeah.
It has nothing to do with the old landscape. These are nonlinear effects and the translation is nonlinear. It's not that you multiply it by 64 that you have it in the landscape. Mm. 1, 2, 3, 4 now. The eigenfunctions 1, 2, 3, 4 now. You can go. Well, let's do it. Higher dimensional and bigger size.
I'm in 4D.
How are you in 4D?
Well, yeah, in 4D it's going to be a problem, but anyway, to show the landscape of you in 4D is also going to be a problem, right? So.
All right. So you got the point. 4D is indeed a problem, but I'll show you in 2D because observing 4D is a little bit harder. But I'll show you 2D. I'm not going to play the potential games anymore. But just to give you an idea, so these are the four deepest wells of 1 over U with the shapes. These are the first four eigenfunctions with the shapes. Exact same together with the shapes correspondence. What happens truly is actually much more magical than that. It's not about the order. The eigenvalues are multiples of the minimum of 1 over U, numerically. Meaning what? There is a constant. This constant depends on dimension only. It does not depend on probability law, on your V, on the maximum of V, on the whatever it is that you care about, on the density. It depends on the dimension only. It's deterministic, such that lambda j's are multiples of minimum of 1 over U. Once again, purely an observation at this point. With location of the maxima of the support, with the maxima of the eigenfunctions, you get it even better with the error 0.05% in these examples. Yes?
Once more, I come back to the same point. How large can j be? Depending on the size of minimum 1 over U?
The J here, so minimum of 1 over U are finite, meaning that there is a finite number of minima on the finite domain. As long as minimum of 1 over U are there, you have a correspondence. give or take.
No, but,
well, that's your answer. There is a finite number of minima, so J is as large as there is a number of minima.
Okay, another way to ask the question is, what's the twiddle, right? I mean, how take the difference, how large is your error you're making if you take the difference?
For 2% in these examples.
For uniformly in J, you're saying?
Uniformly in J.
In the number of items.
Uniformly in J, in these examples. It's magic. I'm showing you examples.
In the example,
it's not mathematics. It's it's voodoo. You know,
okay,
you
check it on the example. Okay.
But it's a pretty good voodoo. I mean, we'll go to mathematics. I promise. So to show you how large can J be, this is 100 minima. The total is about 200, I believe. So there is 100 minima in green here. There is 100 eigenvalues in blue here. This is the ratio. We are in 2D, so 1 plus n over 4 is 1.5. This is the ratio. So to answer you, if J is bigger, it's going to be even straighter. We take another potential, just for the pleasure of allowing the first row. This is the potential from the cold atoms. This is from the data Vincent has given us. The minima are in green, the eigenvalues are in blue. This is only a piece of the spectrum because, again, there are not that many minima. The ratio is here. It's two different, and the curves are completely different, but the ratio is the same, and the potential is different. This is correlated, squared, I mean, Fourier transform, whatever it is that the speckle is. This is the histogram. If you have doubt in the size of our computations, I think this is about 10 to the 6 in 1D, and this is the density of states, and this is the density of states through the minima of 1 over U. Now, back to the question how big J can be. Of course, one big caveat in this entire story, aside from the fact that we understand nothing, and this is, you know, numerical mumbo-jumbo, which looks beautiful, but okay? So one big caveat is that it's only talking about the bottom of the spectrum in some sense. Because, again, there are fewer minima than there are eigenvalues. So imagine the finite domain, there is a finite number of minima, there is an infinite number of eigenvalues. So you are only describing some piece of the spectrum, necessarily. And on an infinite domain, it's still about the bottom. So does it mean that 1 over u is only talking to you about the bottom of the spectrum? Well, let's do another game. The way to address, as a matter of fact, an asymptotic at infinity, which you think you wouldn't care about because it's sort of trivial, but I'll mention anyway in mathematics, is the while law. And the while law tells you that asymptotically at infinity, the integrated density of states, the number of eigenvalues below mu, is the volume in the phase space of xi squared plus phi less equal than mu. This is ultimately true when you go to mu equals infinity. In this picture, so blue is the reality. Green is this while law. It's going to coincide somewhere here. And for very obvious reasons, it's very wrong down in the bottom, and it's not supposed to be precise. If you substitute this V with 1 over U, the curve is red. I suppose I don't need an advertisement here. Another example, Bernoulli. The green curve corresponds to that blue is the reality. The green curve is the classical while law. It doesn't even know that this is disordered because all volume counts for is which percentage of white and which percentage of black you have. So if this were periodic, it would be the exact same curve. It's way off. It's going to coincide at infinity. Here is the, in red, the curve given by the landscape. Now you are probably really confused and you are thinking, well, maybe it's some sort of an effect, a posteriori effect of localization. Here is the opposite side of the spectrum of physics, periodic potential. Blue is the reality, green is the classical while law, red is the landscape. So it's not about localization either. And now I'm going to do something that no mathematician should ever do in their talk in the past 5 minutes, but since we are among physicists, indulge me. I'm going to speak a bit about the understanding of the sense that we have right now, and which has actually been developed literally in the past days, which are somewhere between Christmas and the New Year. So whatever I'm saying, I mean, let's be careful, and it's not written up yet, and there might be, there are many, many open questions there, but this is the first, these results are 2, 3, some 4 years old on the eigenvalues. For 2, 3, 4 years, we have had no understanding of this whatsoever, and I want to tell you what we have right now, and again, this is the results of the past week or something like that, few weeks. Before I do that, actually, let me just briefly mention in the list of applications, yet again, flashback to semiconductors. Claude will talk about this in details. With no mathematical understanding whatsoever, meaning we observed it beautifully for Schrodinger, possibly it only works for that potential or something like this. This insanely complicated Poisson Schrodinger system, we are using the landscape, we are cutting it not in half, in about a thousand or infinite mathematically, because instead of knowing all the eigenfunctions, of which there is an infinite number, we need only one function, which is landscape. We are using these ideas about the Weyl-Lo integrated density of states approximation to feed into local density of states. Notice this is local now. And to use it for approximation of band edges and carriers of electrons and holes. We do the same to evaluate light absorption, light emission, radiative, non-radiative combinations. Again, remember, you care about local effects, so you need an out. Not only this is the system, which is different from what I showed, this is not just the Schrodinger, but you need local precision because you need separate landscape for electrons and holes, the superposition, things like this. But in the end, all of this magically works out, and there are only two graphs that I want to show you over here. One is this, so this is the Urbach tails, or Lipschitz tails, the slope of Urbach-Lipschitz tails predicted by the landscape versus the one in reality. This is the first theoretical method so far which predicts the correct slope of the Urbach tail, and in particular tells you that it's virtually independent in some range from the content of indium, something that wasn't understood. And another example that I want to show you, another point, is this one. This is the time it takes to compute the actual eigenfunctions. This is the time it takes to compute the landscape, and all of this is the landscape. It's an improvement by a factor of 1,000. And, you know, I'm a mathematician, a number is a number to me, 1,000 is a number, but the point is that it's an improvement in which you can do experiments, numerical experiments, which will actually tell you something, because you don't have to wait years, you have to wait days. If you want to test something numerically and it takes exactly 1 year for this thing to be evaluated, that's not super useful either way. This actually gives you a hand on numerical experiments. You can finally do this. Okay, this is what I have for today. This is the joint results with people that you see on the slide and probably more. So please redirect to them if you have further questions, and thank you very much.
I leave you in the good hands of Patrick for chairing the questions. I have to check that everything is in place.
You don't care anymore.
So yet. We have 5 minutes for questions.
Okay, thank you. A very nice talk. It's really a very nice talk. New results and new reflections on energy localization. But I have a question. So in this landscape approach, you insist on regions where eigenfunctions sit, and then with the corresponding eigenvalues and so on, mm-hmm. you can identify in the lowest possible. Mm-hmm. Suppose you would go out for coffee, and mm-hmm. I would sneak into your program, and I would put a hydrogen atom in one of your in your medium, and then you would run your program again, mm-hmm. and you would identify a localized 1s electron, probably perfectly spherical, in your program, and you mm-hmm. would identify this as a localized state. Now you mentioned most of the time localized, maybe not Anderson localized, mm-hmm. but for me, you know, this is a truly bound state. It's not Anderson localized. It's mm-hmm. One s electron, which is bound by a local one.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So, in your approach, you cannot really discriminate between a
no.
real bound state and an Anderson localization, which is a finite number of bound states per unit volume.
Yes.
Okay. Which you, mathematicians, call dense spectrum.
Yes.
Okay. So,
yes.
Can you comment a little bit on that? It's also a bridge to my talk afterwards.
we cannot, I mean, it's sort of the entire point of the approach is to magically merge the two intuitively, which seems to be like, you know, a scene out of Witcher. I mean, you are not ever supposed to merge quantum and classical physics, right? So it's sort of the point that it puts on these glasses, which help to view it more as classical or bound state or something like this. On the contrary, you are right. We cannot distinguish between the two. But because we can have, so somewhat helpful is the fact that because we can use minima or value, whatever it is that one prefers, to look at the spectrum, we can see from the features of the density of states which one it is.
Okay.
So this is the way I were to approach it if you ask me, you know, is it bound state or is it something else or is it dense pure point spectrum? I would use minima to look at the spectrum and try to see that.
Yeah, I just want to make the comments to start the discussion because I think this is a very interesting discussion. And I'm very glad that there is a famous atomic physicist sitting in front of you because 10 years ago when people started talking about Anderson localization of cold atoms, okay, then there was Alain who said to me, we are going to design the experiment such that the chemical potential of the atoms released from the atomic trap, you know, have a chemical potential which is larger. It's written down in the paper explicitly as the random fluctuations of your potential, mu is bigger than VRMS, okay? Just to make sure that we are not in this deep valley problem because that is what I do not call Anderson localization. Okay, you remember this discussion. We have to make sure that whatever we do experimentally, we have to sit on top of all your peaks, okay, and then see it localized.
I totally see your point, and it's part of the game.
What he says is true only in 1D. Because when you are in 2D or 3D, then you can be below the peaks, but have a classical percolation.
Yes, but we know
this
is the percolation
is very low. If you have classical percolation, but that it is localized, I call it Anderson localization. What you say is true in 1D, but 2D and 3D, you have the possibility to percolate in the valley.
But let me nonetheless give one more quick comment about that. There is an ongoing work by Marcel and his student, which is exploring more that and the effect of the landscape on the eigenmodes which are higher than the landscape. The things which I presented, which we solidly have now proved as everything, are all URI below the maximum, so that you are sort of in that confinement from the landscape point of view regime. We do have work on the what you would call Anderson localization, meaning the localization above the maximum. It's involving that divergence, non-homogeneous divergence term, which I sort of hidden under the rug, which is reduced kinetic energy. And there are some results, and I would redirect you to Marcel because he has pictures and everything for that. So we are working on it, but it's not as crisply clear as that. But there is some off print of the landscape, we see it. We don't know why yet.
Last question.
Oh, there are three. Yes.
Can I?
Yeah, sure.
Is there a hope to have good results about the mobility age?
We're hoping with you.
No, but I want to have your intuition because, of course, your method seems to be very good for the lowest lying localized states. But, of course, around the mobility age, it's very interesting.
Right, so this is.
And I'm talking of 3D, of course.
But even, you know, the effects of mobility age in 1D, we hope, and this is based on the results which I'm hiding on the rug here, which I mentioned by Marcel and his student about the off-print of the landscape on the modes which are above the maximum of the landscape. So the answer is yes, there is a hope, yes, there are particular results which lead to this hope. We don't know yet how far. Plus, you know, the speckle potential is not bounded, strictly speaking, so you still have some.
Yeah, yeah.
Peaks which are going. So there are a few reasons why we believe.
The hope
yes.
would be that the landscape, it becomes obvious on the landscape that the mobility edge is here.
Yes.
Because it's the highest mountain period.
This is
my naive hope.
Right. It will be more complicated than that, but nonetheless, I mean, it probably will be more in this context of, you know, density of states, approximate density of states, yeah. Minima count, and so on. I mean, remember that I'm not. I mean, I'm doing the count of minimal per volume, so it's I don't need them to be low, high, or anything. I mean, it persists for large lambdas, and it becomes. So there are a few avenues that we are exploring. The answer is yes. More details on this just have to be discussed separately.
So there is a break now. We can continue the discussion maybe during the break. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.